time on our breaks and also on our lunch break as well. We'll move right on into Mr. Harrison Tillman's presentation.
Okay. Let me just briefly explain what I do. You may not be aware. A number of years ago, government standards changed, and where I used to audit and provide a lot of consulting service in terms of bond issuance, SPLOST, loss negotiations, various special projects, you can't do that anymore. It's an independent rule. They've actually strengthened it. And to the point now, I'm still an auditor to local government. That's actually more than what I do is local governments and nonprofits. Most governments need either a CPA on staff or outside consultant to do what needs to be done to give to the auditor so that they can remain independent. So that's what I do. I prep everything for the auditors. I prepare the actual capital that you're looking at. And then there's special projects also when we've done bond refinancing, I take care of that. And of course, when SPLOST comes up, I run the numbers and take care of that. And we also have loss negotiations every 10 years. We also have service delivery distress negotiations, which I handle not only this county but other counties. So that's just to summarize what I do. But let me go over, I'm going to try to repeat a lot of what's happening. And Mark already covered. But basically, I have a quick overview on my first page there. Just letting you know that the county is in excellent financial condition. They've run very lean government, prevent increases in taxes. But they, like a lot of local governments last year, had to do some. There was quite a number of small government counties and cities across the state who just finally said, we can't continue to do this. We've got to increase our millage rates. So that would be the only one. Prior to the recession, which actually, when I say in 2009, actually I think it was a year earlier, didn't hit Lowndes County for a year. It was a 12-month delay. You could pretty much rely on the inflationary, the growth of the digest and other growth cover all the inflationary costs plus allow for additional benefit to the employees. Those are the good old days. That's gone. Revenues are flat, but unfortunately some of those expenditures are not expenditures you often control. Gas prices are great now, they can skyrocket back tomorrow. Utility costs, which I'll cover later, has continued to rise steadily, and it impacts y'all tremendously. And it impacts a lot of your performance. So the other problem that everybody has seen coming through the recession is they've frozen salaries, they've frozen benefits, they've reduced benefits. They've also cut out all capital acquisitions. But after about 5 years, you've got to get something going. So that's another reason that you saw a number of millage increases. A lot of governments move their capital acquisitions to SPLOST revenues in their new referendums. You'll see what the county did that. It's just inevitable that they're never going to have the kind of dollars to buy capital items ever again. So now we're using SPLOST revenues to take care of that. It's not a big piece of pie for us, and unfortunately, at large. For a lot of small counties that I work with, they can only put road maintenance in there, but they're having to park out capital items like fire trucks, EMS, patrol vehicles, road equipment, all those items. So I've noted the pages on there. If you want to go back and re-review this, you could actually go to the pages and capture and reference them. The fund balance for the county at the end of the year was right at 15 million. It did decline almost 1.8 million. And as was noted earlier, the county changed third-party administrators for their health insurance program. And what came to light was the prior, and that was the mid-year, January 1. town administrator, who was doing the job quickly, compounded by a prior administrator piling on the backlog. And basically, that rose the health fund cost up, like you saw earlier, about 6.4 million or bigger. There was also run-out costs related to them settling up, the prior administrator settling up this claim. I do want to just real quickly, I want to make sure everybody understands that this is a self-insurance program for us small businesses. This is a foreign concept. We usually, you know, get a price from a Blue Cross Blue Shield or United. So there are governments out there who literally are against those taxes. taxes from January 1, and it has when taxes come into effect at that time. It only adds expense. We just got in our county where it's not doing that anymore after 4 years.
So we're doing that?
No, the county's not. We did actually 2 years ago get a TAN set up, but it was never called because of this problem with the general fund having loaned the splash and the cash flow went quite well. We actually turned out we didn't have to draw on it, and we have enough incentives. Now that the general funds we pay back by splash and the bonds are gone, I think we could get some conservative on the erode the cash position of the county.
Going back to the insurance business loan, does our historical data support that we should be doing what we're doing? Self-insurance.
Well, that's really complicated because you can't play what if with the numbers and say, okay, we were fully insured, what would have been the number? Even after you're fully insured, you have to then go to the insurance company, can we give you enough claims so we can calculate what if we were self-insured? So it's really complicated to say, well, we did self-insure, we did a lot better off. Those claims that got doubled up, that's really a function of 1 year capturing 14, 15 months of expense. I can just easily say that my 13 should have been higher, and it would fly a little bit more. So it gets very complicated to try to make that now, since it's a term.
But what I think, Mark, the trend is that when you get to the number of employees, whether it's an agency or a business such as the size of it then becomes a situation that in certain situations, at certain times, that you can save money by being self-insured. I know just run that way down on a smaller scale, more to a personal business standpoint, once you move out into the market itself, and go out there and start getting prices, not in insurance, but there is a tendency to go out there and initially buy business. You go out there and you hit it with a low number, you get that business, and then here's your cutoff, you know. So you just have to be careful about that. But this is the best way to have something in place that you actually can control it as much as possible.
Right, and your TPA is basically using Blue Cross Blue Shield. And that was one thing I did want the county to do, even to my personal detriment. My wife's a provider. She has to deal with Blue Cross Blue Shield. When you get your EOB for the insurance company, it says not to charge the $100, we're going to pay them $50. That's what this TPA and Blue Cross Blue Shield are doing. They're bringing that cost down to what should be paid. And Blue Cross Blue Shield, quite frankly, is there are about four insurance companies in the state at this point. So even if you went out of the insurance market, you don't have much to choose from. Basically, Blue Cross Blue Shield is not a customer's hand.
We really have, I think, the best available because we have the strength of the Blue Cross Blue Shield, but by going through the paradigm, we have the personal contact and the elimination of just being a number lost in such a large organization as Blue Cross Blue Shield. So I was very concerned about being lost and being just one of the numbers. But by our association with Paragon, we really had the best of both.
Mark, I think to answer your question that you asked, basically, if you go back and look over a long-term period, you wouldn't have paid less for your insurance plan if you are self-insured. They'll fluctuate more, but you're going to pay more of a premium to have those level out if you go out and fully insure yourself. Yeah. So I think the long-term range of the employees we have. And that's the thing, small companies can't do it because they're fluctuate too much. But over, when you get to a certain size, and you should fluctuate less, and that's, should have less of a fluctuation from year to year standpoint, with more employees, with more people who are insured.
The other price and cost, I'm very probably solved is well in front of my strong belief in the long term, especially for heart conditions. Because that's another one driver. But unfortunately, it tends to be one. Now, I'm talking about the end point, employee, you need to go to the doctor. Well, then you have to slug it, but you need to go to the doctor. So that's why, that's just a one-time absorption, and you probably caught a bunch of high cholesterol, whatever, rolling up, and now it's being medically managed, and they're saying that's what they did down the road. Any heart-related ailment is very expensive, whether it be bypass or whatever. It's just absolutely. On page two, just to get back to the, here's some general fund history on your expenditures and your revenues. You've got the expenditures in red, and you can see that they've been in the ballpark. The only reason I think the 2014 number, by and large, I can put off on the insurance rising costs, because that was to push back into the general fund. Your revenues, unfortunately, have just kind of bobbed around. I did put the employee count down there for the general fund only to give you an idea that, you know, that these, they're really a correlation, but even though the county has decreased employees and gone up only slightly, the expenditures are still rising. But they held the line on employees only, basically because of need. The good news is, at least for now, I put another chart down. This is a chart I provide to Joe and Stephanie every month, and I track it because I believe it's really important. The loss revenues have gone up in the last 6 months, and you're up $287,445. The growth was there in FY12, going in 13, and then the vehicles were removed from sales tax, and it took a nosedive because state average was, I think, around 24 to 29% of sales taxes on vehicles. So Lowndes County, that's a gift. Now, if you buy a vehicle and you're a resident of Lowndes County, that tax comes back here to about where you buy it. You can buy it anywhere in the country, anywhere in the state, and all the dealers record that and comes back. So that's, we live in a county that's got high in the population, high income, vehicle sales are growing. The other bad part was that hit it right before the vehicle sales really kicked off. You lost all that money, unfortunately. And I'll go over that for detail later. But it is good that the loss has gone up. It's great to see it. And that's been every month we've seen increases. In the past, we've seen 1 month above. These are all growth every for 6 months. It's not growth. And I did know that the revenues have grown only 1.2% the last 4 years. So you can see that kind of percentage is even hard, not even to keep up, of course, even though inflation is low. The next thing, I'm trying to just give you an idea of what this is the, I've got a, but basically, I was trying to show you where your expenditures are going within the general fund. And of course, what is critical here is that even since in FY10 it was 60%, now it's 61%, that is just personnel costs, includes all salaries and fringe benefits. So as you can see, when you get to the budget, the ability to maneuver is very limited because you've got to take care of that big piece of the pie first. And then you've got smaller amounts, supplies, which is just general. leaves you other services. Now, the problem with that one is a lot of that is utilities, maintenance, contracts. It's any service the county buys. Well, there again, those are either fixed or non-controllable. And so, I hate to discourage you before you do your first budget, but I'm just trying to drive home the point that it is frustrating to do a government budget these days, because you don't have a lot of, let's just get rid of that 5% there, and we'll be great. Well, there is no 5% there. It's hard. There's special revenue funds. Mark's already gone, I think it's gone up twice. Those are funds that have been created for a particular purpose that we have to in the special area. I'm on the next page here. So by state law, they have to be in a separate fund in respect to revenue. The most common kind are these add-on fees, as they call them, to the fines and forfeitures. Some come in for jail operations, some come in for drug abuse treatment and education working, some for victim assistance, and some for the law library. And you can see the chart there on each one of them. You can see that they have, they've either fluctuated down, but for the most part, we come at that question. One of the things I have to do for the auditors is they send me any kind of error or a certain amount and say, tell us what this is about. Well, this one's been difficult. I even emailed Beth, clerk of court, to see what she thought. Down below there, you can see all the people that get paid, or the parcels that get paid out. You know, there's 5% for a peace officer duty. Some of these are not add-ons. These are just going into retirement funds for the sheriff, for the clerks, peace officers. Then you see a law library at $3 a case. The jail is 10% add-on fine. Then you have things like the victims of crime is $26 a case. And then they have fees, those are just application fees for families. The what we call our drug abuse treatment and education is 10%. The victims of crime, sorry, is 5%. But then they have these other trust funds that they're sending off to for brain and spinal injury. And then they have some driver education and training. Now, those are attached to every fine. I think you have these other guys that are sending, so there's no money left. They attach to the ticketing fines. So it's not like all the money's going away. Obviously, the county knows them. But what we think is happening, or what I think is happening, is during the recession, when judges are assessing the fine, they can't get blood out of turnover. I mean, you either assess a fine that person can pay, or you put them in the county jail. You put them in the county jail, you're not receiving money from them. They're costing. So there has to be a medium here. While these are called add-on fines, if the judge feels like, okay, here's the medium, the clerk can't go above that. So in essence, they're treating that fine, they're taking that percent out of that, and then the county gets the net result. So this, that's not the only one I saw fine come down. I saw it across the board in the counties.
If y'all remember, Judge Edwards spoke to y'all last year, one of the issues he pointed out about kind of critical of being one, but if the solicitor negotiated with an individual and there was a reduction in an agreed upon plea or whatever, and a reduction in fine, then the judge either accepts or rejects. As I understand it, he does not enter into the negotiations, yes or no. So some of that falls back, those numbers fall back towards the negotiations with the solicitor, if there are cases where it is in fact negotiations.
And the the other pressure coming in on judges, it's pressure from everybody, even the state level. Everybody called these new laws that lock people up in grade. Well, then all of a sudden, the recession hit and the prison calls started hitting state and local governments. And so everybody's been looking at, do we really need all these people in jail? Is it really effective? Is it really accomplishing what the policy is accomplishing? And I'm talking about crimes that are not, they're victims, not I'm talking about drunk criminals, not murders. The annual monitoring system is working somewhat. Some counties are using drug courts as an alternative for drug-related incidents. So they're looking for mechanisms to get people out of prison. There's also a shortage of beds within the state system, so they're even looking at reducing beds and putting, you know, minor criminals, you know, back on the street. Questions, but anyway, that's where that's going. So prison calls, jail calls has become a big issue. I do go through each of these on the next page, the jail law library, to explain what they are. The jail, the county does maintain and use those funds to help break some of the jail calls, but there's noted by Stephanie those revenues are going down, so while it will take everything of relief you can get, it's just not helping as much as it did at one time. The law library is really under the Superior Court judges, and the county has nothing to do with it. They buy a lot of their materials and web-based programs through that, those funds. Victim assistance is overseen by the DA, by the state law. They used to receive enough money to actually help a couple of outside agencies here in the hospital, but it got so small that it's strictly down to the DA and the solicitor as far as, and what, and I believe that one of them has a grant that helps pay for a position. What that's doing is helping people. It gives them someone to talk to help them as a victim through the court system. You know, the perpetrator has a public defender, but the victim doesn't have anybody sometimes. So that's what that program does. I mean, why should they go out and hire a lawyer if they're a victim and they can't properly afford a lawyer? So what this program does, and it's been around a while, is to help those people with rights and guidance. And then the day funds, which also come off of that. Okay, then we get into the special services fund. I just explained how that came about. Service delivery, which is something we won't have to get into for a while, but look. It's a negotiating process where you, each of the local governments has to lay out their services and define what services they're providing, who they're providing to, and how to fund it. And there's actually a paid ACA has. The last time we had one with the cities, there was a lot of talk about the services provided primarily to the unincorporated area. I can always, in that discussion and discussion prior to that, we had always laid them out on paper and said, here they are. Here's the unincorporated services, the revenues exceed the expenditures. No taxpayer paid for this. They didn't feel comfortable with my extraction, so we said, fine, we'll put it in a separate fund. And we have, and it continues to do fine. So I think the law is a same issue. So the next time y'all do have to go through one. I also think that if the counties don't do a couple, the available issues that may come up in the service delivery are very good. So hopefully we won't have anything controversial. Commissary fund, Stephanie went over that about the Christmas resources. Seizures, I just did a graph on that. This fluctuates widely. period, I know there was even a period where it went down because the drug mules, if you want to call that, decided that 75 was the best way to come on. They started going up 95. The 95% started skyrocketing. They also did it, they were doing other things like sending people they knew to call through here, having the resources set up in a bigger level of the dealership. I mean, this is per a previous sheriff's, you know, conversation, but I believe it all to be true. At some point, they've gotten back in the business and it has picked up, but you can have one big seizure in a year and it's skyrocketing, and the next year you never have one of those. Also, it has to go through a long court process. It in the end, it will be a divvy based on the agreement between the GBI, FBI. I mean, everybody's got their hands in it, so you don't know how much the county's going to end up with. And it may happen 2 years after the fiscal year is pursued. So it's just a very, it is nice to have that income because the sheriff will use it, but he has to be very careful because this is federal guidelines too. That has to be used for things that are beyond his normal operating budget. Now that's very important. So, you know, I think we can safely say, okay, you didn't budget these patrol cars. I know you say that they made a status stick on this always these funds. That's what that's about. They're buying vehicles and then using those vehicles to turn around and do drugs. So that's how that's working. The hotel motel tax, I just explained the process. It's a 5% tax. The county used to collect it all and divvy up the respective entities that were supposed to get it. The city and both their own hotel motel, so now the county's only received about 15% of what they used to receive. Is there not that many?
They've adopted resolutions. Should be advertised shortly, requesting the same level as, or legislation.
So that really will be going up. Basically, but will the new, the additional 2% be tagged in tourism or okay? So if it's tagged by the law, currently it's 2%. You have to send that money over there. One of the things I do is make sure that we either capture 2% and I balance it out. We also have to report it in the audit. The state legislature came down very hard on this issue. Evidently, there was some governments not doing the right thing, and they wanted it quantifiable in the audit report. Now we have to do a special note to make sure that that's being done. Of course, you all send it over to the conference center and hands it in tourism authority so they manage those topics.
We also have DCA reports. We have to be very, very concerned that we send that money to tourism, like we're supposed to under that, and how it was spent by the tourism authority.
The other 3% is used for the airport authority, and as Stephanie mentioned earlier, the county, the way that authority was set up under state law, it was agreed in the legislation that the county and the city of Austin would pay 50-50 all the income expenditures of the out of the excess expenditures beyond some revenue side effect. The 50%, the county says that comes out of this money, and they also have to pay some money out of the CERB, that money, the special fund, to balance that. So it's just not quite at the level to cover that. The next page gives some more information on this grant fund. The reason we do that is number one, grants can be very tricky and they can be a mess, especially if you don't handle a lot. So we so we make sure we track them properly. The other reason you don't want them in the general fund, they're harder to track, and your revenues and expenses that we talk around. Some of these can be $200,000 to $300,000 in 1 year, not in the next. So we do put them in special soapbox issue that goes for the meetings. You will have people coming to the county commission and requesting that you sign off on their grant. That is not their grant, that's your grant. It's in the county's name, they'll call it a tax, which makes it sound like, oh, we just get the money, get the thing, we're fine. No, if the federal auditor comes in and wants to review what's been on that grant, guess where they're coming to the county? They're not going to the nonprofit where that grant was passed through. Because ultimately, you're responsible, you're on the hook for it. I think it's been more limited these days, and the agencies that come forth every year appear to be respectable and reliable, but you just need all of them to be aware of that. If you are on the hook.
You also have to use your budget to fill in the total budget straight for now. There are matching funds that are part of the state. Or that sometimes, have to pay a fund and then reimburse as well. So you may be on the hook for half a million dollar training, that you've got to wait to get paid back.
Yeah, I mentioned in there that in the past, we had a deficit in terms of cash flow and that money. And then the counties had to advance money, paper grant. This might be a grant even that should be county grant or even permanent. Because we use a pool of cash system, you'll end up the year with the intergovernmental grant fund only cash back to the general fund. This past year, we did not, but one of the reasons is we have this pending amount of FEMA money. That they say it's probably going to be back, and we'll get about a month, but I think it's been 2 years later. So that's why I'm going to use some money to help keep the cash flow right here. Oh, they did. So much for that.
Stephanie, there's an upcoming community block grant. Is it?
That would be separate. I say, well, you actually have to put that into a separate. It's own blood, it's own bank account. We have to set up a new bank account every time. We have to put extra tables and charts in under that CDUD. We have to be sure to give the audit report to DCA. A lot of requirements for the CDUD. But, you know, they're usually very effective. A lot of small counties have to use them for road work and matching grant. So they can be very effective. The counties use them for a variety of reasons. Some of them just to help local agencies do something. And they're really good at the paperwork is tremendous. I don't know any people who grant on that. 911, as it was mentioned, the dollar and a half fee does not cover the cost of 911. It doesn't mean I don't have a county that I deal with. They put money on the general fund into 911. And the only way that's going to be recognized is the state decides to raise that fee. And I don't know if they're going to ever reimburse that subject. But that would be the only way to rectify that.
Well, you're going to do everything else and just send it down to the rest of the rest of
it. Well, in essence, they have to do is they say that it's a fee. And by saying it's a fee, you have a rising cost. And now you're upside down, you and every other county out there, as far as I know. The XCCG just collects some data on this. I just thought they could ever win the year, even though they got lots of data on how many counties were funding 911 with taxpayer money from the general fund. They also, I think, were kind of hoping that they paid cell phone money to generate enough, and it helped, but then we're seeing those landlines just being dropped right and left. And they already have the cell phone. So now there's every one that goes out of the picture.
As I said earlier, the net on the whole thing is a loss.
I have a chart on the next page that sort of shows that revenue stream. The low point was in FY13 and was down to 2.2 million. And it rose up in FY14 to 2.3. So that's a little bit encouraging. And I guess what I just said about all the counties having to use general fund money. And then we have the county projects funds. This is in but it's still around. This is, it's down to the most, almost 90% of that money is for the other cities. This was under the old SWAS law, and I'm glad they changed this. Under the old law, the county had to get all the SWAS money. They then had to hold, and when the city wanted to spend something for their revenue, they had to turn in invoices and the county would reimburse them. It's a little bit ahead. Plus, the county was on the hook to make sure that it was brought, using the perfect number. When they changed the law, money comes in monthly, and it's immediately dispersed based on the percentage to the city. With that also is a liability for, that means they are responsible if they are doing anything appropriate, since it's their responsibility, it's not the county's. And SWAS 6 and 7 organized that way. We send out reports periodically to these cities, and just to remind them, hey, you still have this amount of money. How long have they actually finished up? I can't remember the ones that were holding out on. With change over the city government, they may even forget a city. Is a city in the county? So we try to remind them, I even put another one at this time and said, please don't use your new SWAS money. Come back and use this money. And as I said, it's time to close this fund down. It's time to end it. We need to get it done this fiscal year if we can get it done.
So do I think next time you check, it's like it's a dash for a name part or something like that?
City of Valdosta, that's where the bulk, and I think it is on Oak Street Extension.
Okay.
Well, that's what you're saying.
Yeah, they're on traffic.
And there's no reason for that, because they just received the with another road project out of SWAT sensors, so use that money and then swap those dollars back. But it doesn't follow the project. Projects can be moved around on their own swaps. And that's what I'm trying to say to them. I don't know if it's getting to the right person. But say, hey, we can go use this money now.
Maybe we send them a little letter, give them a 30-day demand to get it, or we won't use it.
I just asked that question because I think I talked with Joe about it in regards to the jail, when it got completed, we had excess of like a million or whatever. Now, we spent some more of that since that time period, but in theory, say the 500,000 that might be left floating in there that was excess, we can use it towards some other projects or other projects.
Correct. And I'm going to go through a detailed tracking and do it on 7, and I kind of explain it, you know, how I'm talking about that. How we do that is to track it through. Because we learned a lot to SPOT 6. Unfortunately, we didn't know the economic impact on SPOT 6 until about halfway through SPOT 6, which is a terrible time. With SPOT 7, as I mentioned, we knew some problems were there before the first penny was started. You see the SPOT 7 chart. Fortunately, the Department of Revenue has really gotten their act together. We used to see varying numbers when SPOTs evolved, even though it's the same 1%. We couldn't figure out why. But the other thing that's helped, all businesses now file their SPOTs or their sales tax forms in electronic and pay the pick on them. That has tremendously improved the system. So what we see now is that the laws were to go up and down. We see a mirror image in SPOTs, and that's good to know. It just raised a lot of questions in our minds as to what was going on. The other thing we were seeing years ago was big slides we wouldn't have expected it, and then a big outburst the next month, and you just make you think, well, they got it wrong last month, and this is the makeup, because it doesn't make sense. So you couldn't get a handle around what things were doing, so it really improved that situation.
And there's a discrepancy sometimes between these slides and our slides.
Well, of course, I go straight to the Board of Education, so typically, you know, unless they were not prepared, we can look it up on the Department website. It does happen. We track it monthly, and that's what these charts are from. We knew, remember, we had two SPOTs. So initially, at the first SPOT vote, we came up with a, I believe it was $150 million. Revenue estimate. By the time the second one came up, we didn't really want to go back and revise that number. But we were starting to see legislation come out related to excise sales tax on energy, industrial energy. There was 24 sales tax on vehicles. We didn't have any data to tell us, especially on the energy. And we didn't have any data on the vehicles. That actually came out after the fact. The state tried to explain why the sales tax went down, and I first saw the first figure. So by the time the second vote was taken, we knew we had a problem, and by the time, even before the collections were coming in, we did have a start. So we knew immediately that estimated amount, even of the county share. So we immediately started juggling the numbers and getting ready for that. So for evidences, which are much better. Now, when I rejuggled the numbers, it looked like it was going to come in at 84.24% of that original referendum amount. Because of the growth of the city, it's already back up to 86%. So that's good. And on this chart, I do adjust prior to your SPOTS revenue back to the percentage that Lowndes gets, because this changes every SPOTS, the percentage the county and the cities get. And the bottom line is population, but then there's another level that the county will take out of top, and they added SPOTS 6, SPOTS 7, and more of so actually the county is receiving smaller than SPOTS 7. If you turn two pages over, you'll see our tracking system. And this also gives you the referendum items. So you're aware of where SPOTS dollars are going. Basically what I do is every month, there's a four spreadsheets tied into this one. Every month we go in and we got a projected revenue number that's very conservative. We put in the actual and we put in related expenses. So far, idea of the project setting for the expansion of that. By doing this, by doing it every month and by following it this way, we can determine if anybody or any particular project is getting ahead of itself and whether that's going to be the pay or it's going to be the problem. Now, the other thing we did, because of what happened last time, was there's a gap there of the public safety radio. The reason for that is that those items downloaded, we decided needed to be locked in at 100% of the referendum, because some of them were actually geared for that type of electric, like public safety radio. There are indications that actually come to less, but that's indicators that they were needed to lock in. And that's a situation where if it comes in left, we'll probably shift it back to roads, because roads is what the item taken with. Every time the revenues go up, the top items get a percentage of that. So the roads get some more money, might flush as much out of the roads as miserable all the time. You know, cutting the money. And then the water sewer itself, those numbers start rising up, what the system works. On the other hand, if they start going back down, we would say, okay, you guys have talked about taking it or something. The other thing we had to do, unfortunately, was we had to know a couple of authorities, the hospital, the recreation, that we had to cut the money that they thought they were going to get. There was no two-way gravel. Now, they didn't take a hit near the county in terms of their own properties, but they took about 75 cents on the job because the money was not to be there. This way, we're assuring the only authority we had this time was and we're just trying to ensure that they don't have the dollars that was in this. So they don't feel like the cops are going to have the same amount of money. So we'll watch it continually and we'll see how it goes. If you flip all over to proprietary funds. Now the landfill, this is just an old landfill. The enforcement of the landfill, they have this thing called closure and post-closure cost, but you have to monitor for 30 years. We do have solid waste host fees that greatly exceed the cost of that monitoring, so that is good. You do have revenue stream to do that. But we didn't have to account for that liability. Now, I think they're down about 15 years on that, something like that, in terms of the play out. But I've even heard rumors that EPA may come back maybe for a triple P. I don't know how to make that, but
EPA will do
it. And so we'll see how that goes. But folks, your monitoring fund. Now, the problem is if we go beyond 30 years, you could have a leakage or something that could be a very expensive thing. You would think within 30 years that that would all happen. It would happen, but I'm not really glad to know.
What does that monitoring cost?
I think it's only measured about $40,000 to $50,000 a year. It's very small. Actually, the estimate that we're supposed to be, that we're using from EPA on that closure and inflating every year is much higher. But that's typical of the numbers they lay on you at the end. They have really high closure monitoring cost estimate. And it set as a liability in there, but it's just not coming about. That's just, you have to follow the rules and follow the charter. Has done that's been a big thing to around. Unfortunately, you can see my charger utility cost just continues to skyrocket. And every time that goes up, that plays back into the cost you're paying out of that fund. So inevitably, and you had a loss in FY13 of $40,000 and a loss for this past year of $42,000. But inevitably, the rate structure is going to have to be looked at. I agree with Joe that it may have to go up over time. But the bottom line is this was a fee-for-service, basically. And at the end of the day, if it breaks even, that's fine. But it's got to be able to break even. Otherwise, you're going to end up with a huge deficit that's got to pay you back on the backs of those down the road. You're all in pretty great increases would be astronomical. So you want to keep them. Catching a hell of a lot small. And that would be better. And then finally, the water sewer fund is in great shape. The county commission, within 5 or 6 years now, did a rate increase, and it has a very small incremental increase each year. So what has happened is that fund is really holding its own. It had some significant debt that the county does back in the 80s and 90s when they borrowed. The general fund loaded a bunch of money. The last payment on that would be this fiscal year for $500,000 that would be paid back. What will happen actually going forward is now the water sewer fund will have capital to pay for small projects that may be just what we would consider more of a major repair, like $150,000 to $100,000. They rely on the SPLOST dollars for major capital expansion. And so, but you'll have that too if the economy truly picks up. Before it went down, it had great expansion on the north end of the county. Well, that meant that, which is great, this county invested a lot in lines up there. They needed to put something up to it. So that has been great. But if you then start seeing housing developments on the north end or wherever, even on the south end, coming about, you have to respond to that. And of course, that may mean a large amount of money put into lines getting to those locations. And of course, we always wait for cost benefits, but I think you've got an infrastructure in place where it's going to be fairly cost effective, depending on how much growth you're seeing in the area. So right now, we have a great operation going on for water sewer fund. 5 years ago, I couldn't have said that. It was all this other there, but I'm really pleased with that fund at this point. You want me to go ahead and do this analysis by now?
The TA.
Okay. I think behind the next tab, there should be a chart, and I'm trying to explain what this is all about. When they removed the vehicle sales tax, they instituted a new TABP tax that you pay one time and you buy a vehicle. You don't pay property tax every year. You will pay tax, but you won't pay property tax every year. They removed sales tax in Orson Park. Now, it's only been since April of 2013 when it was instituted. This past fiscal year is the first data we have for a full year trying to determine if they were trading off all the revenue as well. So the only way to analyze that is to take all the revenues, the new revenues and the old revenues, and add them up. Lost 1% of the SPLOST, they lost 1% of loss in general fund. And then you're picking out this new tax. At the same time, you have vehicles moving all the DIPS. So at the bottom there, the red line is TADP, and unfortunately, you can see that it's coming up, and it actually hits right on where the ad valorem vehicle tax is going down. What should happen is that red line will continue up blue light will keep coming down as vehicles move off. I think they set a 10-year projection that if anything's left on the highest, that point will just get rid of. Because they figure there's not worth much. I mean, they're just going to take it off the digest wrong space to look at. But that's how the revenue streams go. But you can see the impact that your SPLOS and your loss, because they went down. So when you add them all up, the total effect is that it has generated less revenue. Now, it's not significant in terms of Lowndes County, but it was down. The overall revenue is about $172,000 by that analysis. So we're going to just continue to watch it. I don't know if there's going to be any interest in making any changes to that at all. Actually, the new legislation between TAUP 101, I think that's more about, we want to make sure that we use hard rules. That's all that's about. And for those of us who are not in business, it's complex. And, you know, they I guess they know what they're talking about. There are ways to do it.
You want to hear the overbuzz?
the way they wrote the law is the new car tax to be mutilated. I mean, that's right. How the law's written. It is what it is.
The used cars?
New cars can't be. Used cars can be.
Used cars
can be.
But you say that if they do anything with legislation, it would be to try and correct that.
Yes, the time. They actually have legislation every year since they voted. They're now going at it again. So they keep trying to tighten the procedures. I don't understand all that, but budget will mean more revenue coming in, and this will it'll match up. So that'll help with that. And I hate leaving this glass, this is complex, but we'll go through it. The next is another tab. This.
It is time for the break, for the lunch break, so let's just do that.
I mean, if everybody else don't care, I just want to
know. I agree.
I prefer a break. My voice is going.
Can we agree to come back in about 45 minutes?
Absolutely.
Instead of
Yeah, of course. I'll try again 15 minutes later.
12:45.
We'll be back.